from Cleveland, Ohio, Newsboys in concert at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Love I ever knew. Give it up. For coming out on a special night for us, and I hope it is for you too. This is the release of our brand new CD, Thrive, which I tell you, you people are the first people in the world to receive this CD. So we've got no better place to come to than Ohio. I tell you one thing, over the years, if I've learned one thing, that is that the God that I believe in doesn't need me to prove that he's real. The God that I believe in doesn't need my cash. The God that I believe in just wants me to serve him and trust him and trust him and seek his kingdom. And the God that I serve, I love about him, is that he sent his son and he's who I want my God to be. Okay. Thanks so much for coming out. We saw it was so much snow out there today. We thought, well, no one's going to turn up. We're going to have a good time anyway. But it means so much to us that you guys all showed up. What a great bunch of people. We'd like to play another new song for you. This is a song called Rescue, and this pertains to... The Bible says that we work out our salvation with fear and trembling. And sometimes that gets taken out of context, that we must work to be saved. But I really believe that there's nothing we can do to make God love us more, and there's nothing we can do to make God love us less. His love is unconditional. No matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, His mercies are new every morning, and we can be rescued every morning. His mercies are new.
You
This is my favorite cut on this record. It's a track called Million Pieces, and how do you know? This is a song that, you know, in light of what's happened over the last year or so in this country and around the world, it just seems so amazing that we get ourselves backed into a corner. And it seems like there's nowhere else to go. We can't rely on anything, including ourselves. That seems to be the best place to be. But the only place to turn to is our Creator, who made us and takes our weakness and turns it into completeness. This next song is about freedom, but it's about real freedom. It's about the freedom of a people that are able to go through the eye of the needle, leave themselves behind, and to cast your cares off and to give them over to the one whose yoke is easy and burden light. And I believe that as that is our Creator's Son, Christ. So be free on this one.
Say
These guys are from right here in the wonderful city of Cleveland. Please welcome the New Testament Tabernacle Choir. I tell you what, that song never sounded so good with you guys on it. I'm ready to go home now. This next song has been a favourite of many of the fans for a few years now, and a lot of people ask us what it means. I'll tell you what it means. It means that when one of us, just one person on this earth, finds the grace and the mercy that is only offered through the Son of Jesus Christ, what a great God we serve that sent His Son. And no matter where we've been, what we've done, what we've gone through, those that turn to Him, I tell you, the road is narrow. But I can tell you one thing. I know in my own life, there is more grace on this earth than there is sin. And I believe when one person finds that grace and that mercy, whether we rejoice or not, I don't know if that matters. But I know without a doubt that the angels in heaven rage when one person comes to know Christ. That's how we can entertain them. found, and I like it. Yeah, I like it.
Do you know who this is? Do you know who this is? Give a big Ohio welcome from the supergroup, the legends, DC Talk. One of my favorite arch enemies in the history of the world.
Hey, don't forget where you got your start.
I know, we started right with you, buddy.
I know.
Mr. Michael Tate.
Thank you so much. But I must say, this is not shameless promotion of my good friend Peter Furler's band.
It is shameless because he couldn't remember the lyrics to the song we told him to learn. I call that shameless.
Wait, Peter calls me two nights ago. He goes, "Hey Tate, you want to come up and sing on this project with us?" And I'm like, "What are you talking about?" "Well, we got a new record out. You should sing the song with us. It's called..." And he gave me like four songs to learn. My attention span is this big. So I had to bring it out, sorry. They rock, though.
Give it up for Mr. Michael Tate.
I'm not afraid to die.
This next song is the title track off the record, and it's a song that those of you that know the Bible, there was a man named Jacob, and he was someone that wrestled with God, and God touched him, but not in the way that we always think that, oh, God touched me, man, it was great. I'm not sure if Jacob woke up the next day feeling that way, because Jacob was touched, and he never ever walked the same again. And I think that's what it really means to thrive. And I think when a seed falls to the ground, it can't bear fruit until it dies. And the camel can't go through the eye of the needle until it loses itself. And that to me is what prosperity means. It ain't riches, it ain't fame. Man, we had all that, and it ain't nothing. But I feel to thrive is to lose yourself and follow the upside down kingdom. The kingdom that says to find life, you got to lose it. And blessed are the poor in spirit. I want to be poor in spirit. This is Thrive.
Thank you.
Here's a little song. You better know this one, otherwise we're really in trouble.
thanks for coming. God bless you. Good night. You guys are ruthless, ruthless people. I just got one question. I know it's late, I know it's snowing, I love this place, but do you like breakfast? Duncan seems to think you don't really like breakfast. You're gonna have to convince him. He's had a long day.
I hold the milk, put back sugar. They are palace to be so. We gathered here to sprinkle ashes on LA Prince cereal pump. Breakfast on the same tomato.
You see, we've been playing this song for a few years now. I think it's about the only song in the set I can remember all the lyrics to. But I'll tell you one thing. We played in Norway, Sweden, Switzerland, Finland, London, New Zealand, Australia. We even played it in Canada. But you see, everywhere we go, I let the people know. I say, look, folks, whether you like it or not, you might as well just get over it, get used to it, learn to live with it. Those Americans are the loudest singers in the world. This TV special is going to go into about 70 million homes. So it's going to be all places around the world, all places around America. And I'm kind of wondering, is it possible that the loudest Americans in America are from Ohio? Possible, right here tonight we could have the loudest Americans in Ohio. So let me get to you. 2, 3. When the toast is burned out, doing okay? Alright. The reason why I'm out here is because they don't let me play guitar very much in this band, so I gotta keep my distance, you know what I'm saying? This next song is, I think it's my other favourite off the record. This is a song that, you know, a lot of times when we walk this earth, we feel like as people, especially as Christians, as believers, that we have to have the answers for everything. You know, I don't know if that's necessarily true. Because sometimes we move in these areas where we find peace that passes all understanding. How can you explain that? You find joy that's unspeakable. It's unspeakable. A lot of times we feel we have to defend God. I don't need to defend God. I love God and I know He can. He does mighty and marvelous things. He can even do things through animals, for goodness sake. But I believe even the desire to desire God comes from Him. There's a famous author Thomas Merton said, "Lord, I don't know where this is going or how it all works out. And I don't know your ways. And sometimes I feel like I'm following your ways and I may not be. And even the desire to desire you comes from you. And I believe we have a great Father who wants to give us what he wants to give us. Give us great things." And that's what this next song's about. It's a song of praise. And if you're a believer, let's praise him. Redeeming what's been done, you hold us in the present,
and all that is to come.
Thanks so much for coming out. We love you, Julie. God is great. God is good. He isn't always safe, but he's always good. Blessings on Ohio. Cheers. See you later.
Yeah.
My name is Philip Joel, with one L, and I am the bass player for the Newsboys.
My name is Jody Davis, and I play guitar for the Newsboys.
My name is Duncan Phillips, and I play drums and percussion.
Hi, I'm Jeff Frankenstein, and I play keyboards with the Newsboys.
Hi, I'm Peter Furler. I sing in the Newsboys, play a little bit of guitar, and every now and then Duncan lets me play the drums. We've always felt like we were a basketball team or something that has to take on the world. You know what I mean? When we go and play concerts, it really is about, it's never been, I don't think, about anybody in the band about self-promotion. It's been about, we're kind of in this together. It's like we've gone through tours together, we've gone through tragedies together. And so it's something that those things haven't, where they might, with some, unfortunately, strike and send everybody their separate ways. With us, it's just made us huddle closer together. And I think that, that's why it's a daily thing. I think we take that one day at a time. And I would hope that people that would hear our music, that understand what we're about, may walk away a little differently than when they came. I would definitely hope that. I hope they would feel something, something that I can't create, and something that I, God forbid, I ever try to create. And I hope they just sense that and see it. But in the end, it's not our responsibility to try and create that thing for us. It's our responsibility to seek first God's kingdom and to love one another as we want to be loved, and to treat our wives as, Christ loved the church. And these are all tough things that seem to be take up enough of our time.
Hey, I mean, being in a band was good practice for being married, because you really have to learn how to compromise and really give up what you want and do things for the greater good of the relationship. And but luckily, I learned so much from the other guys in the band. You know, I don't know, we haven't really talked much about the other guys in the band, but these guys have been my family, for the last 9 years. You know, I've spent pretty much every day with these guys. We know everything about each other. And, they've been, I'm the youngest guy in the band, so they've been, some have been like best friends, some have been like bigger brothers to me. And, it's just been a great, great learning experience. And they accepted me as one of their own from day one. You know, it's been amazing, yeah.
You know, we've always been guys that really wanted to remain true to who we were. And we've often talked about this and said, you know what, we do what we do. And if it goes in a certain direction and we go start getting more play in this area, on this radio station or whatever, great. But we made a decision not to seek after it, because I think really as a musician, no matter who you are, you just got to be true to who you are. You know, don't try to be something you're not, because sooner or later someone's going to see through it, and whether it be fans or someone else are going to see through it, and they're a bunch of fakes. That's not who they are. You know, I've seen a lot of artists, and I've got a few in my mind right now that I might say that have done it. You know, they've tried to be something, they've started out being one thing and they've been successful and it's been fantastic, and then they've tried to do something maybe a little more hardcore, edgy, or something that they're not, and fans just see straight through it. And so, I don't think we could. I couldn't go up and sing about sex, drugs, and rock and roll. I just couldn't do it, because it'd be a lie for me. It wouldn't be what's in my heart. So, I think that's with us. We've always just sung what's in our heart. And when we first started, we kind of started playing bars, when we, years ago, first played parties and whatever we could. But as we kind of grew as men and matured and spiritually and in all these ways, the Lord took us in this way into playing. Well, there wasn't really Christian music when we started. We just started singing about our beliefs and what was in us. And when we first came to the States, that was when we were categorized, I guess you call it, a Christian band. So we were very happy with that, though. Very pleased.
The fellowship of the Newsboys is really kind of informal. It's something that it just happens so naturally that we just consider it a blessing. It really is. I mean, we, it can be usually for us, it's on a tour bus, or we have a pastor that, you know, he's a great teacher, Ray McCullum, that comes in and, you know, shares with us whenever possible, hopefully once a week if we're fortunate. And it's just, call it what you want, but I call it God and His providence, but it always seems to be something, we're all getting touched at something at the same time. In a sort, it never seems like we're out of sync spiritually. And whether it be books or, you know, someone might be reading something and next minute everyone's got it. And so we're kind of, you know, and I believe this is, you know, a miracle that we're all seem to be on the same page. Most of them, we're very individual. We're completely different people. We'll argue and fight just like brothers do. And but at the same time, there seems to be a hand that guides us and holds us all the time. And the fellowship is, to me personally, is very precious, and it's something I don't take for granted.
Yeah, I don't know if we have any sort of prefab philosophy as to what we do on stage, you know, and why and how it works, because I still don't really know. But all I know is I really enjoy it. You know, it's fun. I think we all do. I think we've still got a little sparkle of newness about performing. It's just it's still strange to me to think that, you know, we're going to go out there and there are going to be people there wanting to hear us and watch us perform. So it's exciting. Every time it's exciting. And I think the day that it gets sort of dull and ho-hum and maybe we... and we start taking it for granted, that's the time we need to get off stage or rethink what we're doing. But it hasn't come to that yet, and so the energy is still there, and we still really enjoy being on stage and enjoy being a band. That's why we got into music, you know, I think, initially to hang for the hangout and be in a band. And so that spark of companionship and energy is still there, which is, it's good. It's good. I hope it never leaves.
Firstly, what I'm proud of, I guess it starts in, as a fan, you know, of the music. It starts as a, you know, for me to write songs, I have to become a fan. I have to sort of sit down and think, what would I want, you know, Newsboys, not so much to do next from a marketing campaign or a... even what's been done before. Sometimes what's been done before is the first beacon that says, don't do that again. You've tried it once and that was fun then. By the time you've gone through all that process and you sit down, you sort of end up throwing everything out and just writing as a fan and writing music that you want to play at that time. And that's what I'm most proud of, because it turned out that way. You know, a good percentage of the songs sort of really turned out how, you know, we wanted them to. And then from there on, the reaction to the fan, that's different. I mean, you don't know who comes and buys you. Once they buy that CD, it's theirs, it's not mine anymore. It's their piece of real estate. They can go and listen to it. They interpret songs differently than what, you know, what was intended for them. Sometimes better, I think, than the original. And so it really does become theirs. And how they will react to it, I don't know yet. I'm not sure.
You know, I know that this album has elements in it that is really gonna relate to people, you know, because we're all humans. We all go through the same thing. And I know a lot of the things that we went through, people out in the audience are going through too. And hopefully, there will, I think more than ever, these songs will relate to the people in the audience.
We've had regrets on every record we've made. That's what keeps us going, you know. It's like trying to always become better as songwriters and musicians and as artists. And I think that, you know, we've had previous records where, you know, I always felt there was one or two or sometimes three or four songs that really hit it on the mark, and maybe they were the ones that propelled the record. But I'm a believer in trying to make a great record, as opposed to just having two or three singles and then the fan kind of turns it off after track three. I mean, I like it to be an experience, and maybe, you know, maybe this CD is something we've gotten a lot closer to than previous years.
There's a lot of ideas that come through, and Pete brings a lot of stuff in, especially on this last record. I think he really dug in and woodshedded for a long time, had probably spent a lot more time this time than ever before. And so there was a lot of stuff that had come through. And so, you know, he's not afraid to just bring it all out, you know, the good and the bad. And so, because you never know. I mean, sometimes you'll have stuff that you're thinking, nah, this isn't all that great. But then when everybody else hears, they're going, no, no, that's it. That's a good piece, you know. That's what we really need to do that or whatever. And so it's really, yeah, I mean, it's pretty amazing to when you think about through the years, just all the different concepts and things that has come out of that and how good they've really been.
Well, this is always my favorite time of, you know, whenever a record is made, there's usually like a 3-month period before it comes out. And to me, I think personally is a great feeling because it's a huge weight off of our chests, you know. Before the recording process, it's a massive amount of stress and it's a massive amount of work. And, you know, basically every day for like the last 6-7 months, you know, I've been in my bedroom sitting on a computer, you know, just trying to come up with parts and programming and all this stuff. And so it really feels like a big stress relief, you know, to me.
I'm still a fan of Thrive, where I can still hear the track Million Pieces, and I feel really good about it. I can still hear the track Giving It Over, and I really like that track. There's still certain tracks. Obviously, for myself and the rest of the band, we go through such a huge process. A guy like Duncan's a guy that sort of comes in, plays the drums, and then he sort of leaves, and we don't see him for a while. And he kind of unwraps the CD, you know what I mean, and hears the songs, which I really love that because I rely on him for his input from stepping right out of the circle. Then there's other guys such as Jody and Jeff and Phil, are people that are there the whole way along. And once we've gone through the process of recording the CD, of you know, getting all the sounds, matching them, throwing some out, bringing the new in, and then mixing it, we must have listened to the songs, you know, I don't know how many times. So it's a good sign if the song still rings true when it's when the CD's coming out.
Well, I think the Newsboys is a musical unit. I mean, I'm really excited about the future. I mean, we've had an incredible past, and I think when you start writing records, you write it from a very, you know, childlike perspective. But as you grow, you know, you do start to write better songs. You start to understand what works and what doesn't. You know, and I see this record Thrive, this latest record Thrive, as a real milestone for the band, because you know, I really feel that it's a band where we've all been playing for a long time, and it's a combination of all those pieces coming together, and I really believe it's the best record we've done to date. I mean, you know, musically, playing, you know, we've all played, you know, probably the best we've ever played on a record. You know, lyrically, I think some of the best lyrics are the best songs by far. But what is great is I think it's the just the beginning.
Well, obviously, you know, the fans would be pretty much, you know, a huge part of what we do. I look out in the crowd sometimes and I don't understand our fan base. It's mind-boggling to me how you can see every different age group and every different type of person that I've ever seen at a show. And I think you know, with the kind of music that we play, it is a very unifying music. You know, I think people come together, and our fans know that they're all a family, because we are a family, you know, in a spiritual sense. And so I think it's a powerful thing when all these people come together. And it's, you know, I mean, we all kind of go through our daily lives, and, you know, we all may go to different churches and believe different things. We all believe the same basic thing, but, you know, when all these, you know, it's one of the few times where you have all these different age groups, all these different denominations of people all come together. And it really is almost like church in a way for people. The meaning of the night becomes bigger than just a concert. And I think people realize that, and that's what makes our fans so psycho, you know. And they are psycho. I mean, they're, you know, they give it 100% when they're there, you know. No one's really standing around. We won't let them.
Well, I think our music to the fans is different things to different people at different times. It really is. It really is an interesting mix. To some people, it's they delve in and pull things to pieces and sort of dig for some sort of theological diamond. Other people just want to know that we're good guys. You know, they just want to know, are they good guys? And that's kind of the bottom line sometimes for a fan. Is that guy living what he's singing? That's all I want to know. And if he is, then thank goodness for that, because maybe I can do this too. You know, maybe if they're still living their story and they're still moving and they're still progressing in their faith after all these years, great, because I am too. And I need some companionship, because I know it can get lonely at times. You know, it's interesting. I heard this quote recently, which I thought was really amazing. It's a Mark Twain quote that said, "Most men die at 26, but aren't buried until they're 70. And I thought, that is genius. That is really astute. You know, I see a lot of people get beat down and over the years and just settle for the status quo and settle for just sort of mediocre faith and a mediocre walk with the Lord and a mediocre church experience and a mediocre worship experience. But there's no way. There's no way I'm going to settle for that. And we as a band, we're not going to settle for that. And I think our fans feel that and know that, and it motivates them. And that's what it's all about.
Whenever we do play a show, there's a lot of different things that happen. You know, I think for some people, it's just a great show and a great band, and they come and they enjoy the music. For some people, they take away more than that. They take away a spiritual message. Some people may discover things in their spiritual life that they never knew about before they came. So I think there's a lot of different things and a lot of different aspects of our show.
The amazing thing about rock and roll over the last, you know, bunch of years is that it was always something that divided people, you know, in the early days. Now it is something that really unites people musically. We see parents, I mean, we get so many parents bringing their kids out to the show. But to one step further than that it's not really necessarily a plan of ours, but it happens. I believe it happens in the crowd because it happens with us. Each of us have, I guess you would nearly call us different denominationally in the band. But yet when you come to these shows, there's all these different denominations all together under one roof. And they may not even know it, I'm not even sure. But we've tried to keep our venues something that is, neutral ground, if you want to use that term. And it creates this environment where you have all these different denominations coming together under one roof and this massive amount of unity. And I think they leave their baggage at the door. And I think it's because we've left our baggage at the door. It's more, there is a higher purpose than just, what we believe about, predestination or Catholicism or whatever it may be that's your bag. There's a lot of times behind all them things can just be yourself, and we must get rid of ourselves. And so to get rid of ourselves puts Christ first. And when you put Christ first and only Him first, there is unity. And I think that's where it's never anything we've planned on purpose. It's just happened naturally. But there's so many different denominations that are out at each one of our concerts. And to me, that's a success more so than gold records.
Every day is a challenge, you know what I mean? I think, all of us, go through things, you know, we're not superhuman people like everyone might think that we are, but we're trying, and hopefully, with every day we're becoming more like Christ. I mean, that's the ultimate goal, you know.
You know, all of us, you know, especially since the last, you know, few months of, what's happened in this country and over the years of, there's always, wherever there's some sort of tragedy or adversity, somehow humans seem to be able to flourish, you know what I mean? And you see prisoners in China because of religious beliefs, and yet they are living what they believe much stronger than we are here in the comfort of our own homes. And I think there's something about, there's the wicked side of evil nature, you know, human nature that we can go on about, but there's the great side of it. And I believe it comes from somewhere. I believe that you know, when we see signs in creation, whether it be the ocean or the trees and the turning of the seasons, and if we stop and look and take notice of them, which we don't, because many times I myself, I'm so caught up in, you know, and just sort of getting by, you know what I mean? Just it's not so much taking even one day at a time, but it's, we can be so worried about college and about car payments and about what we're going to do for the rest of our lives, and yet that didn't matter to these people on September 11th, even, that, you know, got into cabs and kissed their families goodbye, you know, drove, got to buildings, and then all them college degrees and all them, you know, mortgages and all them dinner appointments and all them things didn't mean anything anymore. So I think for me, I've got to a place, hopefully, that I daily sort of, you know, think about, you know, where have I come from, you know, and what am I doing here, and what's to be in the end. And it's not so much a matter of just fear, it's a matter of finding fulfillment, you know what I mean? I know we all search for it in different ways. Many of us in our early years try to get through cash, through women, and through success, through notoriety, and all these things do have merits, or they do have they have some remnants of joy for a season, but I think it's remnants as in like a shipwreck. When you land on that island, you look around and you see, you know, what maybe could have been or what should have been. You're just seeing pieces. You're not really getting a taste of completeness. And I've found it myself. I really do believe that Christ is who he said he was and is. And I don't believe I believe that because I'm any better than anybody else, because believe me, I'm the worst of all of you. But I believe it by the grace of God. I believe that, you know, those of us that ask God, he is like a father that wants to give his children the good things. And there is many, many mysteries involved, but there are many, many miracles as well. And I believe for myself, the search isn't over. Maybe in every area of my life, there are still things I wrestle with. Society does seem to create the need, doesn't it, so it can fulfill the want. But I myself, at least, I believe it is well with my soul because of Christ.
Probably the biggest thing spiritually for me that's happened in the last, well, probably almost ever, happened with our daughter was born early last year, and that in itself being a very amazing thing and a life-changing thing. Then shortly after, about a month after she was born, she had kind of a near-death situation, and it was a real miracle that she lit. In fact, there was all the doctors at Vanderbilt Hospital basically said they couldn't find a case that had where a child had gone through what she'd gone through and survived. And so we spent a lot of time in intensive care for a while, and then at that time it's the strangest thing, because while it was the most scariest and the most horrible thing, right in the middle of all of that, I probably had never had more peace in my whole life. And there was something about this time and being with our daughter and helping her through this thing she was going through, where it just washed everything away. And it was the clearest I've ever seen anything in my life as far as how God works in our lives and wants us to live our lives, and how he wants to cast our cares on him and have that peace that passes understanding. And
I became a father 17 months ago, and it's funny, I realized when I got married, I realized what a selfish pig I was. and now that I've had a child, I think I'm doing something about it. You know, It's strange. You get married and you realize, okay, there's more to life than me. And when you have a kid, you definitely, it's definitely a motivation to become the person you're meant to be. Because you have to be. You have to be, you have to grow up, kind of thing. You know, it's a pretty adult thing to do to have a kid. But so in the last 17 months, there really has been a lot of soul-searching moments. I really want to be the man that God wants me to be. I want to be the person that I was created to be. I don't want to miss out on anything. Because if I miss out, my kid's going to miss out. And so I want my relationship with the Lord to be as on as it can be. And so that's really, really forced me and pushed me into a position of becoming disciplined. You know, I really learned a lot about discipline and about seeking the Lord and about trusting Him and about really pushing in, because I'm a bit done with myself. I'm a bit sick of me. I'm a bit sick of my sort of ideas on how things should work and my selfish ambitions and my dreams. They've kind of lost their shimmer a little bit, and which is good. It's about time. And I think that the birth of my daughter has really sort of been the catalyst for that. And so thank you, Finley, for that change.
I think spiritual awareness can come through, you know, life experiences, such as, you know, I was recently married this last year, you know, and when you get married, you learn a lot, think about yourself, you know. And I think the marriage was created by God, and I think He planned it, and but you really realize how selfish you are, and how I think it's in a spiritual sense, you really have to give up what you want and really humble yourself, and that's been an amazing thing. And it's also been an amazing thing how, you know, God can bring two people together, you know, and it's just been unbelievable. You realize, you know, just, I don't know how to explain it, actually. I'm not even going to try.
Talking about being, you know, having a spiritual milestone, I guess, in my life, it sounds weird, but the day I got married for me was, it was a spiritual experience for me, because, you know, for so many years I'd strive to you know, better my craft as a player, and you know, we were touring and working very, very hard, and you know, I used to go out with some girls here or there, but it was funny when I got to a point where I said, you know what, I'm not going to try to chase after this anymore. I'm not going to go date anyone anymore. I've had enough. You know, just God, you do what you do, you know, and I'm just going to become the best drummer I can possibly be. When I got to that point, my wife came along. And the day I got married, it was such an incredible thing for me. It was just like, finally, I had this sense of completion, you know, and it's an ongoing thing, of course, anyone who is married. And it's not always easy, and it's not always a bed full of roses, but I know that I'm much more of a complete man now than I was the day I got married, so to speak.
A spiritual event that there hasn't been one thing that's defined, that's changed each of us individually. It's been lots of things. There's been lots of, it's like Jacob was somebody that was a Bible character who wrestled with God, and he was touched on the hip. And he was somebody that he never walked the same again. And each of us, I believe if we're blessed, we have these moments, and they're moments that we don't ever walk the same again. And we walk with a limp, or it's like we see it in the events of September 11th. We see people's lives change forever. We see it in young children that are born blind or go blind at the age of 12, that they have a special gift that goes further than those of us that take for granted our eyesight. And we see it in we see it at funerals, and we see it in weddings, and there is something special that happens when, you know, calamities come into our lives. What we do with that adversity is really the decision that's the most important. And for each of us in the band there, it just all sort of happened at once. There was many, many things, some of them sort of too personal to talk about, but there were things that would, you know, that changed us. For myself, it was it was realizing my fallen nature and myself, and being a product of, you know, being a product of this system, you know, how we can offend each other and we can be so offensive, and protecting ourselves and our rights, and believing that we should be happy at the cost, at any cost, even though it may cost others. And I don't think that's what happiness really means. I don't think that's what justice is. And learning to not try to change the world or other people, but to be the change myself by the grace of God that I would like to see.
I think the significance of the band recording this release of Thrive at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is, well, for me personally, it's a sense of history. When I came here the first time, I was just in awe of all my idols growing up through the years. And it's almost like now I feel like I'm a part of that family. You know, because it was all like, you know, when you start out and you're young and you're putting all these hours of practice and you're working all week to work on the weekends to go and play a show. And then over the years you go and you progress and you work hard, to me it's almost like a musical milestone to come and play at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. It's like, it's almost, in a way it's not, but in a sense it's like you've made it, in a sense, you know, to a certain point. It's like you get to play here, because, you know, just walking around and seeing how other people write their songs and their instruments, it's just like all those things that you've done that you think no one else does, like doing your practice and all, and, you know, writing out lyrics and you know, and all the way that you write stuff. And then you see like your John Lennons and all these incredible songwriters that have done stuff exactly like you have. So it's just like, oh, okay, well, maybe I am a part of this family in some way. So, yeah.
The most exciting thing for me about playing at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame is that I grew up loving music, and I grew up, and at a certain point, I made a commitment, and it's a commitment by the grace of God I want to keep, and that is to follow Him. But I always struggle with why the two, it's like why one of them got me in trouble and the other one got me in trouble at other times. Why, whether I was playing rock and roll, whether there would be certain Christians that didn't like that, and then I would be playing rock and roll as a Christian and some rock and rollers didn't like that. So either way, I was sort of a dead duck. But I think what I like about this is times are changing. I like the fact that I just want to make great music. That's all I want to make, and I want to put on a great concert. But above all that, I want to serve my Creator in doing that. I believe these gifts, I believe the gift of music is just like the gift of life. It's up to you what you do with it. Many rock stars can use it for selfish gains and them only, and then others can use it for selfish gains and humanitarian reasons, and the rest of us hopefully struggle in between there. But it is an honor to be able to play here, and it's, you know, to be invited here was something that maybe there are people that are putting aside the stereotypes and the baggage and saying, are they any good or not? That's the question. I grew up in a country where there was no such thing as Christian music. I mean, what is that? You know, to me, it's, you know, I believe music's from our Creator. I believe it's His, and it's up to you what you do with it, just like anything else. But I think now maybe I'd just like to people say, you know, I don't mind someone saying, I just don't like that band because of this or that. But when they say, I don't like because you're Christian, you can do better than that. You know? Steve Taylor to me is firstly a friend. And I value that more than any of his talents. We're very blessed in this life to find people that encourage you and uplift you and do many things so selflessly, and Steve is one of them people. He's someone, I think I love him because of how much he loves us and the way he does. You know, he's a huge fan of the band, and he's one of the only few people in the world that get the Newsboys and what we are. And we are an original band. Whether people like us or not, we're not a copy of anything else. And he gets that. He's somebody that when you first show him the demo of a song, maybe what the world outside or maybe the certain people would consider trash, he considers a treasure. And so he sort of starts brushing the dirt off and he sees it before a lot of other people do. I guess he sees it the same way a songwriter does, because he's a songwriter and he sees it, he knows what it will become because he's been down in the trenches himself and had to dig for a few nuggets and try and find some diamonds. And that he's a great man of integrity, a great person to be around, and he's definitely, man, our industry, I would say, I would go as far as to say rock and roll, period, would be much lesser off without Steve Taylor. The collaboration is a massive blessing. I believe it was a defining moment in my life when I met Steve. And, you know, it's kind of like there are many songwriters throughout history, and I think if you look at a lot of the greats, great songs that were written, a lot of times it was written by a team, a collaboration, you know, of sort of, it comes from the Bible, I believe. It's ironing sharpened in iron, as one man sharpens another. For us, a lot of producers and a lot of songwriters, you got the Lennon and McCartney, where else do you go? So it's like you have many, many people. So I always feel that I feel I write a better song when Steve is in the room, and I feel like we make a better record when Steve is in the room. And it's a pleasure for all of us. Creating the songs for the Newsboys CDs consists of usually myself. I go home and have a little concert at night by myself. You know, I'm just there and I have some samplers and guitars and keyboards. I get inspired by sounds. And so sounds, to me, bring out melody. And so usually I sit down and I'm a drummer at heart, so I come up with sort of some sort of rhythmic aspect to the song, and then I, you know, get the basic melody down, and then I, sometimes I'll have a chorus lyric or an idea, usually the concept behind the song, and then I'll go and burn a CD in this modern age and put it in Steve's mailbox, you know, and he comes along and gets it out and calls me the next morning and usually is a confirmer again, you know, confirms what I was hoping, that we're onto something, and he takes it from there, and we both sort of work through it from there on out, and just finish the song right from going into the studio to the end of the mix.
What Peter's function is he's probably the main visionary. I mean, he was he started the band originally, and he's the one who's really, more than anybody, just always thinking about, well, let's see, how can we do this better? What can we do here? What can, you know, he's always, you know, it seems to always be in the forefront of his mind, and you know, I think we all play a more sort of supporting role to that. I mean, of course, everybody has ideas and concepts but you know, he's kind of there to just kind of sift through everything and grasp the gems out of all the ideas that come through. For me, in my role in guitar and in the Newsboys, sound, for me, it's almost been more of knowing when to stay out of the way. You know, it's like playing, you know, letting the focus be in the song, and then just trying to work things in that. Trying to make everything a little bit of a hook, but not to take away from it, from the melody of the song.
I'm kind of in the back, so me and Duncan, we call ourselves the backline brothers. You know, we're kind of the second line of defense if the front line fails or kind of falls apart. You know, we kind of, we're kind of busy back there. We're not, you know, right next to the fans as the other guys. But you know, we have a good time. We look at each other and crack jokes and laugh. You know, we have a good time. So hey.
you know, to me, I mean, the title says thrive, and I think a lot of times the worldly, you know, the mainstream kind of connotation of thrive and prosper means that you've, you know, got to have the big fat house with the three cars, your boat, and your holidays and all that rest of it. And that those are all great things. But I think coming from a Christian point of view, it doesn't necessarily mean that. To thrive can mean to your relationship with your wife or your spouse to prosper and grow into something that it may not have. It can be your relationship with your family, with your neighbor. It can be in your relationship with Christ himself. You know, there's so many avenues that, and sometimes it actually can take an area of not thriving in the natural to prosper in the spiritual or in another area of your life. So I think God's kingdom is kind of like an inverted way of what we look at. We think, well, we've got to have this to be successful. But Christ says to lose yourself, to die to yourself every day, and then you'll prosper. You know, it's real hard for us to work out, but I think the thrive meaning, okay, you know, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these other things will be added unto you. But we tend to go the other way. We tend to want all the added things first, and then we'll kind of come and, you know, the other way in the back door. But no, seek me first, and then.
You realize that things are in God's hands, and only when you let everything be in God's hands and you trust him with that, can you really thrive? Can you, you know, you struggle and push and try to do all this stuff and do, you know, and be a success at whatever. And you realize, you know what, it just doesn't mean anything. To thrive is to have this peace with God and to know it.
Thrive is a track that was really based on the scripture. It says in the Bible that unless a seed falls to the ground and dies, and it cannot bear fruit. And that's what it takes. I imagine so many lives have changed in this country over the years because of hardships. And it's like sometimes I saw upstairs, it's Malcolm McLaren had made a statement that said, everything must die for something else to be created. I'm not sure he knew what he was talking about, but I believe that too. You know, I believe that from a biblical standpoint, I believe that for the camel to go through the eye of the needle, it has to lose itself. And I think that to lose ourselves, it's like the kingdom that I believe in is an upside down kingdom. It's a kingdom that tells you that to find your life, you have to lose it. You know what I mean? And blessed are the poor in spirit. And so these are the things. And to love one another is about losing yourself. It's giving up your opinions and giving up your ways for the love and to serve somebody else. And I think to thrive, that's what this really means. It doesn't necessarily mean prosperity. It doesn't necessarily mean success. It doesn't necessarily mean to have great fortune. These are the things we can only see the rich men of the world that seem like they have reached the pinnacle of maybe where some of us wanted to be, but they don't look like they have found it to me. I'm more jealous of someone like Mother Teresa that had the stamina and the grace and the fortitude to stick with it and see the kingdom, the place for what it really is. She really knew what it was to thrive. From the message point of view, the songs have to have been lived, and they have to. We had a song titled Joy, which I wrote that song probably at the deepest, darkest time in my life, and everything seemed to be falling apart for me. We'd had a lot of success in our field. We'd made money, and we kind of had everything from a world's perspective, from this kingdom's perspective, but we didn't really have it anywhere else, you know, and I just sort of lost touch with what makes me complete, my faith. And so I came to a point where I was just had nowhere else to go except back to my roots, you know, and back to digging out further, reading a lot of books and a lot of works from great authors, you know, some of them you know, 1,500, 2,000 years ago. And it was just, it was a time of, it was that cold and broken hallelujah, as Leonard Cohen quoted, you know. And for me, that was where I really found joy in that, and in amongst all that, where I guess I really had nowhere else to go but to the Lord, you know what I mean? And that was where he really opened up my eyes, and I found a joy that it is unspeakable. And so it's so hard to talk about. And but those of us know it, you know, we know it when you find it, and many, many people on this earth find it on a daily basis.
Talking about the song Giving It Over, it's probably one of my favorite rock tracks on the record. It's just talking about, you know, giving it over. You know, it's really self-explanatory. We tend to hold on so tight sometimes, you know, even to our relationships and what we have, and you know, even our standing at church or our position that we hold at work. But I really believe there's a comfort. It sounds weird, but there's a comfort in giving it away. Just say, you know what, I'm not gonna stress and worry and have all this anxiety, because you know, we can really start to hold on to things and say, well, that's mine, and I've got to nurture it, and I've got to pet it, and it's, oh, you know, like this. But you know what? Give it away, and it'll all be added back to you tenfold. We're talking about the song Million Pieces. That's a song that to me speaks of, you know, God can get us and almost break us into all these little shards. And I think sometimes that's the way that's where he wants us. And when I hear that song, it talks to me of God getting all these pieces, getting all these shattered pieces and putting them back together, you know, like a craftsman would, you know, just getting all these pieces and putting them back the way he wants them and molding it into something that we could never become ourselves. Well, Breakfast is one of those funny little ditties that we wrote quite a while ago. And it's just a fun song. You know, it's a song that was written with Steve, and, you know, Steve's, you know, got away with lyric. And, you know, they don't serve breakfast in hell, meaning, you know, you can do all these things, but wipe that. Well, Fad's a song that talks a lot about almost like a rock star, you know, all the trappings of a rock star and the day in which we live, you know, the culture in which we live. And it's just really not making fun of it, but just making aware of, as you know, rock stars, we can tend to want this and want our, you know, red M&Ms and all this real weird stuff, as we do. But you know, when all that's said and done, it's all pretty funny. You know, it's all pretty ludicrous. You know, when you.
The song "Live in Stereo," I think the main message of that song is how, you know, when you see the world through God's eyes and the way that he created it and the way that he intended it to be, how everything looks differently. You know, I think even, although the song is kind of a fun and upbeat song, I think, you know, we've seen a lot of that ever since last September and what happened, how when, you know, we saw a lot of people really reach out to God for help. And I know that when I get up on stage and I look out at the crowd and I look into their eyes, that things are different now. You know what I mean? I know that when I walk through a city and I look at the big buildings downtown Cleveland here, everything looks different now. And you know, when you see the world through God's eyes and how his hand is in everything, it's a different perspective. I think It Is You is really just a very simple song of worship. And that's really all it is. You know, I think it's a song of acknowledging that you know, we are nothing without our Creator and what he's given us and what he's done for us. And it's really just a big, humongous thank you, really, yeah. the song Lord really talks about how, kind of like what we talked about before, a lot of times, you know, people look at Christians and expect us to have all the answers, and a lot of times we're quick to pretend that we have them all, but sometimes we don't. You know, sometimes we don't know the deeper meanings behind things, and sometimes I'm perplexed by things that I read in the Bible that I still don't understand. I don't know if I ever will. But sometimes those things can be frustrating, but we know that, that Christ offers us a peace that's beyond understanding and that we can rest in that, even though all the circumstances of life and everything that it brings are sometimes too much. You know, he offers that rest and that peace, and that's what that's about.
Shine is a song that I think Gandhi had a statement that said, you know, we must be the change that we want to see. And he really got that from the Bible, because Gandhi was an avid reader of the Bible. And he was someone that, read a lot of Christian literature. G.K. Chesterton was somebody that very influenced Gandhi tremendously. And it comes from the scripture of Matthew 5:16, I believe. Don't quote me on that. But it's in the book of Matthew, but it says, let your light shine before all men, and they will see your good works and glorify the Lord. And I think it seems like in our subculture, we feel like we have to stand up for God. What a joke. You know, we have to prove that he exists. What an even bigger joke. And we have to convince people of their wrongs and their injustice, where I think we should start with ourselves first and let people... I would always wonder what would happen if this would be something that would probably get me in trouble for saying, but hey, I'm always in trouble. But I would guess what would have happened if Christians were the ones that raised the funds to destroy the AIDS virus, to come up with the technology. What would happen? What would that really say? I don't think that community looks at us to be people that are loving and kind and willing to put our money where our mouth is. And I think it's time for us. It's obviously what we're doing now is not working, because I don't think we're connected to Christianity in the aspect of what Jesus walked and talked. And when I say that, I really am speaking of myself. I can't walk that walk yet. But I know people will begin to change when they see the change in me, which only happens through Christ. Rescue is a song that kind of really touches on several things. But I'm a strong believer, obviously, in Adam and Eve and the fall of mankind. I'm a believer that, we are so affected by our parents, whether we had parents or not, even that affects us, who they were. They were affected by their parents. They were children once too. And it seems like there's this trickle-down effect that has happened. Even Adam and Eve, their lives, and you've got, Cain and Abel. I mean, they were parents. Well, one of them was a parent that obviously had a great effect, being a murderer and being exiled. And yet still that had a trickle-down effect all through humanity. And so I believe that we work out our salvation with fear and trembling. I don't believe that we work out what it is to be saved, because I believe that there's nothing we can do to make God love us more and nothing we can do to make God love us less. His love is unconditional. I believe that those that believe that Christ is who he said he is are saved. But we work out what is this gift that we've been given. To me, it jacks with me every day. I don't understand it all. I have to rely on the mercies that are new every morning. And I ask for my daily bread. And but in turn, we live in a country here within God we trust on the dollar bill. And it seems like one thing I hope doesn't happen, but it seems like we forget, it becomes so mundane and it's not a personal experience for us anymore. It's like the Israelites in the old school, the Old Testament, they were people that God would do these great things for them, and then they'd go through 50, 60, 70 years and forget about him, you know what I mean? And then they'd get themselves into trouble and cry out to him again, and then because they forgot him, and then they'd remember him when they were in adversity. And so we still sort of live that life today, and I think it's a song about not only being rescued, but being rescued every day.
Well, Take Me Cheerleader is kind of it's a goofy kind of song. It's a fun song to play live. It really is. It's kind of got a good sort of bounce to it. And it's a fun bass song to play. It's really just about, it's kind of along the same lines as Shine. It's really a fictitious sort of story, really, about someone who is has run the gauntlet of options and in life, but sees something in their neighbour that they haven't tried yet and can't figure exactly what's going on. And they basically approach this person and say, "Hey, what's going on here? Let me know." And the chorus, of course, is "Take Me to Your Leader." And essentially, like Bob Dylan said, you're going to have to serve someone. We're all under somebody, whether we know it or not. And so the question is, take me to your leader. And that's kind of the challenge to those who are followers of Christ, to take others in that direction. Entertaining Angels is a song that is kind of loosely based around a piece of scripture in Luke 15 that talks about when one sinner repents, the angels rejoice. And it kind of paints a little word picture there at the front of the song about basically, it's kind of painting a word picture about being up late at night, like between 3 or 4 in the morning, in front of the TV. And where I'm from in New Zealand, TV goes out at 12, you know. Night-night, bedtime, and the TV goes fuzzy. And so there are many nights where I would be sitting up and TV would go out and it would be me, the fuzzy television, and God. And those were some of the most amazing soul-searching times for me. And I spent quite a bit of time, you know, between those hours of 3 and 4, I guess, on my knees, returning to the Lord at certain points in my life. And I know that a lot of people have the same sort of stories about those midnight hours, those late hours. So in essence, what was going on at that time, or those times of repentance, those times of returning, was that I was entertaining angels. The angels are poised, ready to party and be excited when we repent. And so it's kind of an interesting thought to think that, you know, God's waiting for us and wanting us to return, and his angels are ready to party and rejoice when we do.
How are you? So tell me, what are your favorite hobbies?
Oh, that's too close.
I like knitting.
You guys going? We're leaving now.
No.
We're going.
I'm sleeping.
You what?
I want to sleep. Big day tomorrow.
Oh, so you're not coming to lunch?
Yeah, I'll come to lunch.
Coming, Helmer?
Yep. Momentarily.
Okay. Camera. All right.
You got a nice haircut today.
Yeah, so have you.
So this is for the DVD.
Oh, great. Yeah. Great. Thanks for telling me that right now.
Well, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got a bit of a shadow. I need to cast a bit of a shadow on you.
Is that
you building a barbecue?
That's better.
No, I'm not too bad. That's it.
Good morning.
Good morning,
sunshine.
How are you?
It's a beautiful day, isn't it?
Yeah, lovely day. What are your favorite hobbies?
I like to play chess and backgammon.
Say hi to all the fans.
Yeah. What's up, fans?
It's very early in the morning for us here.
Yeah. Come on, Steve. Shake your leg, will ya?
He's only got one.
Bunch of stuff torn up.
Oh, great.
It's nice. Morning.
We're on our way. We're leaving the hotel as we speak.
Okay,
see ya.
There it is. Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, Wes.
Where is it?
A little glass building over there on the left.
Oh, on the left.
Yeah, one house
here. Coming up. Here she is.
I think it's interesting they built Cleveland and not like a
beautiful Cleveland day.
Cleveland's away.
Hello, Cleveland.
Sammy's Grill. Sammy. The grill. Jump right.
What's up, Cleveland?
Beautiful. See the grill.
That's a burger right there, ladies.
It's got an egg on it.
That is a burger.
What's the word, Doug?
The word is I'm about to eat and I'm a hungry man right now.
Oh.
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 So.
Pepper.
Egg on the bird.
Oh my gosh.
No
ketchup, please.
No beetroot for the burger. Right?
No beetroot, no pineapple. Guys, this is going to be just the most amazing thing.
But they toasted the bun too.
Oh, that's good. Looks good.
Oh, amazing.
Thank you so much.
Take care.
We're going to make dinner soon tomorrow.
Okay.
Nick would be the best guy to ask.
What?
Ask him if he needs a push.
Oh, gosh!
Need a push?
Excuse me.
You need a push?
Oh, the battery. Yeah, we can push it.
We can get it off the side of the road.
Somebody lost their hat.
It's fine, just throw it in there.
I might put it on full flat.
He's got cables. We can give him a jump start.
Get him on the other side of that light,
you want to push him around the corner?
Yeah.
It's bloody freezing out here, Nick. You know?
It's so cold out there.
I know.
It's just wrong.
Ice bullets.
Yeah, okay, see what we can do.
Let me out and do this. I don't have a... Give it a shot.
Action!
Hey guys, let's go. I'm going to be late.
Hey guys, it's gig time.
Okay.
Oh, no. Around the corner.
Why is everybody gonna make a dumb face when a camera comes around?
Because it's a natural reaction.
Just like that.
To an unnatural event.
This is a rock star here.
So he comes back after a half hour wait and says, here's your.
There's one here. This is when people stop pretending and get real. Ladies and gentlemen, Robert Plant.
I'm sick of middle-aged women chasing me around. Peter Frampton, Peter Frampton. It's better than getting,
hey, Bob Dylan.
Brush my teeth.
Yeah,
very nice.
Very
nice.
One of
those.
These are Chanel. Very secretive. Aging. How about this one?
Yeah.
Covers the bald spot.
Oh, there you go.
Their shoe Scam. Cam craze.
Hope he remembers to turn up.
Fight the man.
Where are we going? Come on.
Rock and roll,
we're
in the Hall of Fame.
Rock and roll,
RB Theory.
Are we here
there?
That's
it? I think this is us. I think we can.
Yeah, RB Theory.
Oh, cool shoes, man.
Hey,
what? Where did they
go?
Wait, I went behind
the
camera.
Got the
lyrics
down,
there you go.
Problems. Yeah. Love,
seven.
I ordered some shoes, so I'll be like,
it's not just a rock band.
We gotta go to Morton's and eat, dude. It's time.
Let's do it.
Mr. Spent $80 on this.
Anyone else? Anyone need watches or anything you need me to hold?
He likes his accessories. That dude just snaps off.
This is coming off. Security can arrest me later.
Just stay right behind this thing. Fans
are right there.
Good job hyping the crowd, dude.
Thanks.
Hi.
Hey.
water and then lots.
Seagulls!
That's gonna be great. That's gonna be really good. Yeah.
All the balconies.
That's gonna be right here.
Right here. Right right here.
Oh no, I've done it spit on me.
Trying to save a little
maybe
bit.
We need
it.
A... Ah, go away!
We need it. Does it look like a campfire, Jim?
No, it's not the warmth or anything. You've got to come up here and listen. I can't.
So how do you save? Do you like each song you go through? Like you got to make sure I just store it, save it.
What I would like to be honest with.
Entertaining angels.
Joy.
Joy.
You can't go into interview for that.
Yeah, I can. Just do the black guitar.
Alright.
Maybe we should start with who?
Get it out of the way.
I could talk about my favorite song.
I'll be a bad song story.
Alright.
I don't know him. The Rooster Crows.
Jody.
I do not know him.
Oh, that one, yeah.
That's bad.
Sound amazing.
Thanks.
That's up to Jody, too. His harmonies are so good, dude. Great harmonies. No, seriously. Great harmonies.
Oh, you guys just make your way up.
Man. So we don't run into the
animal. Will you meet us in this place? By your mercy and grace.
It's just a walk on and go.
Another hour?
Okay.
Yep. Boys, rats butt there, let's do it. Let's do it. Let's go.
Let's do it.
Let's go, eh? Take it away, Mondo.
Stairs right over here.
I'll be out there in a minute, boys.
Right up there.
And the thing kept turning and whacking him in the teeth.
Oh man. Not you guys again.
What?
No one told me that. Voice is like talking quiet. Like,
this guy's like, they're trying to. Level. Can I get level? Level. Come on, closer.
Thanks a lot, guys. Yeah.
Now just speak up on you, you have a little conversation, and all of a sudden this hamster comes over your head.
Early Michael Tate there, pal. How about that highlight, huh?
That was hot, man.
Dude, no, seriously, we came in, we were like, me and Wes, that was the moment, that was fun. It was like, Andrew, Wes looked amazing on the camera.
What was that?
Wes looked amazing on the camera.
They say you look 3 pounds heavier on camera, man. I hate that. I hit myself in the head with the guitar, it's pretty cool. I don't know, you know, I just felt like it.
There was a couple of wigs on the front row. These guys had little colored wigs. I want you to grab one and put it on for the song. Hey guys, the choir sounded amazing.
Yeah.
Holy, holy, dude.
That was
got chills.
Same here. I stopped singing. All of a sudden, like.
I was. Oh, it was amazing.
How are you instrument?
Madison.
Hi, Madison. How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good, did you have a good night?
Yeah, it was great.
Thanks.
Watching the audience was one of the most incredible things for me tonight. And watching kids this big and parents and everything in between, and they were with you on every single word. And I've seen bands try new material for 25 years and fall on their faces. And tonight, I mean, it was just amazing. You had them. We are truly blessed to have had you here tonight.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank
you.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah.
Yes.
Feeling the experience.
Very comfortable.
What you have behind you here is a bunch of Bono's costumes here that were used from like the Zoo TV tour and a couple of the other tours. The devil suit behind there is also his. And over to my right here is a bunch of Zeppelin stuff. This is the Mellotron that was used on all of their records.
Right, yeah.
This acoustic guitar there is what Jimmy Page played Stairway to Heaven on. And down here you can see Bonham's drum set. And, this is what's known as the drum set.
Yeah. I still haven't been it yet.
Yeah, and the gong is down there. And a couple of the outfits at Page and I don't know if that was Bono, it's John Paul Jones's. That's Jimmy Page's there with the dragons and stuff on it. And then his bass is over there as well.
It's amazing how they're in such good condition, even the Mellotron. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
I saw one of Mick Jagger's over there at Mellotron. Yeah, it was just in mint condition. I mean, it's so hard to find, you know.
Yeah. Well, and I think that was part of it too with those kind of instruments. You know, you're not going to trash them. And remember, these things didn't go on the road either.
Right. Yeah.
They basically stood in studios all their lives, or somebody's basement. And I mean, when you look around at some of the other instruments here, you'll notice, you know, Duane Allman's guitar. I mean, he played it a lot.
He wore that. Yeah.
And when you look at Pete Townsend's guitars over there, or Keith Moon's drum set. Pretty beat up, you know.
We're lucky to have one of them, really.
You need my gear, Dave. It's up on the stage.
It's pretty beat up.
Whatever you need, it'll be there.
Get a vintage 9501W.
Lyrics, we'll take song lyrics. We love song lyrics, if you guys have them.
It'd be hard to
There's
get.
A, yeah? You throw them all out.
Well, right? I mean, but I mean, over the years, you know, it'd be precious to have handwritten lyrics of certain songs.
I can't believe how many lyrics were still around on the Lennon exhibit. I mean, we must have kept everything.
Over there, that when the cameras are off, I'll take you into where everything from Chuck Berry's original lyrics to School Days to Del Shannon to Talking Heads, Aerosmith, Paul Simon, I mean, all that stuff. And it's been preserved. Donovan had this whole lyric like pad that he wrote everything from Where Your Love Like Heaven to Sunshine, Superman, Mellow Yellow, all in this one pad.
Oh wow.
And he kept it going.
Now we got the stinking laptops, you know.
Right. You know, and that's a problem right now for us, because a lot of guys, like I was talking to Bono about it, and I said, you know, get me some lyrics, and he goes, well, I'll just print them out. Yeah. I said, what do you mean? He goes, I literally do everything on the laptop. He just sits there and version 1, version 2, version 3, take this. He says it's great. I can just, you know, take a paragraph take a chorus and move it over to here.
Pretty soon you'll be collecting laptops.
Yeah, that'll be
hard drive. Right, you know, just a hard drive.
That's right. On this laptop.
Yeah, there'll be keypads.
Beautiful day was written on this.
Yeah, I can feel it. Collectively, through the five guys, is pretty much every item of something or other in here is going to be interesting to one of us.
Uh-huh.
You know, because it's interesting. I mean, we're all from different parts of the world, so we've got all kinds of different influences that have pulled together, really, to make what we do. But, so it's fun being in here all together. And visiting the Motown section with Oinch. He's from Detroit.
Oh, okay.
And there's not a lot from New Zealand in here. Actually, I'm the only thing from New Zealand in here. I'm just going to be passing through.
I'm not sure of that, but okay. Might be some Easy Beat stuff, you know?
Maybe.
That's right.
I like seeing, you know, AC/DC. They're a band that was playing high schools, you know, when I was growing up.
Right.
And my elder sister, you know, they came to her high school and played the high school show.
We've got one of Angus's shorts and suits here.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
In fact, we had the big bell from Hell's Bell.
Oh, really?
That was kind of cool. I mean, Australia's been such an influence, you know, Midnight Oil, and, you know, there's Bee Gees and NXS, and there's been so many bands that have actually come out of there that everybody thinks they're just English.
Right, yeah. You know? Well, the 70s and 80s, especially for Australia, was when I grew up in the 80s there as a kid, and that was just a powerful time because we had the best of American music and the best of English, you know, music. Radio stations were finally getting their act together and playing all these tunes.
Right.
FM came in then for us in about 1981, you know, and so they played them all, you know.
Have you gone back and visited, like, the whole Zeppelin collection or the whole Beatles collection or, you know, James Taylor's and Marvin Gaye's and Stevie Wonder's?
Al Green, you know, I love Al Green. Yeah.
There's Al Green's suit right over there.
So I always go, you know, I go and at least start with their hits collections and start there. The Beatles hit collection was great, and Al Green's one, you know, was one I wore the cassette out for a while there. they do.
I think when you go around here and you see the influences and there's a section where you can actually go and take a band like U2 and follow them back to who they say their influences are, and then take those influences and follow them back to, you know, music of the 40s and 50s. You know, there's such a common thread going through it all that, you know, the music you're making today is not that far removed from Bill Haley and the Comets and some of the, you know, Elvis Presley and Jerry Lee Lewis and Little Richard and those people. There's something of that that, you know, made its way through. And yeah, it's one of the beauties of the museum.
Yeah, it's cool because even guys like us, we can trace back, like you say, influences and their influences and so on and so on. And it's almost like the family lineage and realizing, you know what? It's almost like that guy's my great-great-grandfather to this thing I'm doing now and what we just did on this record a little bit of. And I didn't even know it, you know, which is kind of, that's fun. I did do that downstairs on the computer. It was fun.
My name is Michael Tate, DC Talk, and of late, my brand new band, Tate, my solo band. And a lot of people don't know this little bit of history I'm about to give you, viewers, but the Newsboys and DC Talk toured together for the first time, for the Newsboys' first time in the States ever. They came over like in 90-something, I can't remember, like the early 90s, and we were on tour. We were just breaking in the States, DC Talk was, and we took the Newsboys out with us, and the stories are plenteous. We could go on for hours about the things that happened, from us wrestling in our boxers in the dressing rooms, which is kind of scary, I know, to eating at Denny's on the road late at night, arm wrestling, and have people's arms broken in half, literally like compound fractures from arm wrestling, to all kinds of stuff. So being here today, basically, is an honor for me. Peter told me he was really excited about me being involved, and the band felt really good about it. But just as much for me, I'm excited because this is a piece of history for me. These guys in DC Talk, Toby and Kevin, myself, we go back so far with all kinds of stories. And they've always tried to be kind of like DC Talk. But they actually found their own groove now, so I'm glad. That's for Peter. Oh my goodness, rock and roll is... It's pretty significant being here tonight at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I mean, rock and roll is such an expressive form of music. You can say so much with so much punch. And obviously being here where all the greats are either on the wall in photo form, photographed, or their underwear or their suits or whatever, Bon Jovi stuff is over there behind us. It's a weird just being here because, you know, we enjoy pop rock today, and a lot of the forefathers, what do you want to call them? The forerunners, the front runners. A lot of the front runners are represented around us. So just being here and being inspired, my goodness, I mean, what can you say?